Hey guys, Level Cap here. Today we're taking a look at the top 10 World War II video games of all time. My criteria for the top games are ones that were both popular, but also deeply memorable. Leave a comment below with some of your favorites, and be sure to subscribe and turn on notifications to catch more videos. Also, there's a lot more than just 10 great World War II games, so why don't we start off with some honorable mentions that didn't quite make the top 10 list, but were darn close. Sniper Elite 2 might not be the most interesting World War II game ever made. It's pretty much a fancy shooting gallery set during World War II, but its X-ray bullet-time sniper nut shots and approachable yet somewhat realistic gun mechanics really set it apart from other sniper games. It's combined the best of arcade shooters with more tactical nuances of milsims. Since Sniper Elite 2's launch, the studio behind it has gone on to make two more games in the franchise, as well as an entire spin-off with Zombie Army. Now, the second honorable mention that didn't quite make the top 10 is Day of Defeat Source. This is a remake of the original Day of Defeat, which was a Half-Life 1 multiplayer mod. Valve bought the rights to the mod in 2003 and released the game officially the same year. Day of Defeat Source ported the original game to Valve's then new Source engine. It included a number of effects and technologies from their flagship Source title Half-Life 2. These included dynamic audio systems, realistic audio filtering, HDR rendering, motion blur, depth of field, and more. At the time, these effects brought a greater sense of realism to the game that put it above many of its peers. It wasn't necessarily groundbreaking, but it still holds up to this day, and the game has a very dedicated following. All right, let's get to the actual top 10 list. Starting off with number 10, we have World of Tanks. Released officially in 2011, it's since gone on to be one of the most successful multiplayer vehicle combat games around. The month after it launched, it had 3 million registered players. Today, it has well over 60 million registered users. World of Tanks essentially pioneered the modern free-to-play vehicular combat game business. Before its release, most free-to-play games were either adventure games like RuneScape, EverQuest, or Lord of the Rings Online. Many others were strictly designed for the Asian market, but World of Tanks was one of the first vehicle combat-focused free-to-play games that took off globally. It has an incredibly complex and deep vehicle mechanic system, with every tank having unique stats, weapons, armor, and more. Mastering this game pretty much requires you to be a human spreadsheet of tank knowledge, but it still knows how to have fun and remember that it is a game at the end of the day and not a war simulator. And to be honest, World of Tanks would be higher up on this list as it has so many good things going for it if it weren't for the extremely aggressive microtransaction model that makes a big portion of this game's vehicles inaccessible to the average gamer, somebody not willing to pay hundreds of dollars. There's also a pretty good argument that many of the mechanics could be seen as pay to win. Brothers in Arms Road to Hill 30 is number 9 on our list for a lot of reasons. It's a squad-based FPS game that was designed from the ground up with authenticity in mind. Many of the game's assets, characters, and locations were modeled from their real-life counterparts. However, what really set Brothers in Arms apart from the crowd was its focus on squad shooting mechanics. You had control of multiple soldiers in each mission, as well as tanks in some parts. You could direct them to move, defend, or attack specific targets. At the time, this was a stark contrast to the one-man army design of popular titles like Call of Duty and Medal of Honor. By 2005, there had already been several FPS games trying to cash in on the Call of Duty World War II craze. Most of them just attempted to replicate the action set-piece formula to mixed results. Brothers in Arms might not have been the best-looking World War II game, nor was it the most complex or varied, but it bucked trends and added a level of depth that you didn't see in your typical World War II single-player game. Where most other shooters had you running around with laser-accurate death rifles, Brothers in Arms introduced a sort of sway and suppression system to make combat more stressful and dramatic. By today's standards, it might be a bit outdated, but in its heyday, it stood out from the crowd for all the right reasons. At number 8 on the list, we have Red Orchestra 2. Now, the first game, Red Orchestra 1, was actually a total conversion mod for Unreal Tournament 2003. It won a contest sponsored by Nvidia, giving the developers a free Unreal 2.5 and 3.0 license. They used this to create essentially a standalone version of the mod for retail sales. Red Orchestra 2 launched in 2011 and expanded greatly on all aspects of the previous games, offering more weapons, locations, and vehicles. It also helped push World War II multiplayer trends away from the flashy HUD and zany perks of other games and focused more on realistic weapon mechanics. There was no heads-up display for your ammo count. It had a first-person cover system that let you hide behind objects and peek or blind fire, and there was no health regen. If you take damage, you're hurt until you die. This was the game for people interested in experiencing a more realistic and less set-piece driven experience. It also featured 64-player matches on large-scale maps with tanks, APCs, and even recon planes. The interiors of the tanks were also so detailed that they rivaled other tank sim games of the time. Red Orchestra helped usher in the modern wave of realistic FPS multiplayer games. Not only that, but it also helped propel the studio Tripwire Interactive to one of the top spots in indie game development. Their Killing Floor franchise is now one of the more popular zombie survival shooters, and the spin-off of Red Orchestra Rising Storm is also very successful. Number 7 on this list is World of Warships. And honestly, I personally would place this a bit higher up, but I know boats can be a tough sell for the average gamer. Made by the same developers as World of Tanks, World of Warships delivers a similarly arcadey multiplayer mashup of World War II warships slugging it out on the open seas. And although it might seem like a simplistic point-and-shoot game on the surface, it's actually a deep strategic game that blends extreme knowledge of artillery and armor values with shot prediction skills and a chess-like strategy. Its primary game mode pits 12 ships against another 12 ships with a mixture of ship types that all perform different roles. It's extremely team-oriented and requires players to work together in scouting, fire support, and baiting enemies to attack. This free-to-play title also lets the average gamer access a much wider variety of ships compared to its more aggressive World of Tanks counterpart. That's not to say that premium ships won't cost you a pretty penny, they just aren't needed in order to enjoy the game and have a fair fight. War Thunder. Our number 6 pick features World War II naval, air, and tank combat all under one roof. However, the game did just start off as the flight sim component, and much of what makes War Thunder great comes from the experience its developers gained while working on an installment of the legendary flight sim series IL-2 Sturmovik. I pretty much have to give IL-2 Sturmovik an honorable mention here, as it is one of the most heralded flight sims of all time and a fantastic World War II game. War Thunder's flight sim component is essentially a more accessible version of IL-2 that's designed for every level of player. It features an arcade mode, realistic battles mode, and even a simulator battle mode. Each one has an increased level of difficulty and complexity and realism. It's amassed over 15 million players since its original beta launched in 2012. It should be noted that War Thunder does go beyond World War II combat with some of its more modern vehicles, but the majority of the gameplay is still World War II centric, and that's how the game started off. Its tank and naval battle components are also great additions to the game, though I would say most people know it for its flight component. Number 5 on this list is a bit different from the traditional World War II titles. Return to Castle Wolfenstein is an alternate history World War II game where the Nazis are trying to harness the supernatural forces to create a paranormal army of the undead. You play as the franchise's star character, William B.J. Blazkowicz. The single player set during 1943 World War II. In it, you hop around several European locations, tracking down and thwarting the plans of several Nazi scientists and soldiers. It's a tight-knit, action-packed adventure that offers a ton of variety in its level design. The weapons are also pretty varied. There's everything from your typical MP40 and Mauser rifle to the outlandish Nazi Tesla gun. Despite launching in 2001, Return to Castle Wolfenstein still holds up quite well today. The cinematics and voice acting might leave a lot to be desired, but the core gameplay is still top-notch. It also features a badass flamethrower capable of shooting flames around corners, which was particularly fun in multiplayer. Its legacy today is carried on by Machine Games. Their 2014 reboot of the franchise, titled Wolfenstein: The New Order, launched the franchise to new heights while also remaking the game as an even more alternate history saga. It fast-forwards the events of the franchise to 1960 in a post-war era where Nazis won World War II and essentially took over the world. Number 4 on this list is Company of Heroes, the only real-time strategy game that made the cut, but it's one hell of an RTS title. The game allows you to control your troops in a similar way to something like StarCraft. You often fight to control areas of the map, earning resources to expand your arsenal with additional soldiers, vehicles, and weapons. The single-player campaign spans several notable American operations during the Battle of Normandy. You start off with D-Day, then work your way through the Battle of Carentan, Operation Cobra, and other iconic operations. The game features fun fortifying and cover mechanics that realistically portray how both open field combat and urban combat might actually unfold in real life. The visuals were also quite good for its time and really helped to create an immersive combat experience. Despite the real-time strategy elements, each mission also had a distinct storyline with major characters and plot points. It's a very deep and nuanced RTS game that had spawned several spin-offs, a direct sequel, and even a direct-to-video movie. Many people consider it to be one of the best RTS games ever made. Not too shabby for a game from 2006. Call of Duty World at War is number 3 on this list. It took all of the improved mechanics and level design Call of Duty 4 Modern Warfare pioneered and applied them to the classic World War II era. Despite COD 4 cementing the franchise's dominance in modern military, Activision wasn't ready to totally give up on World War II games just yet. Call of Duty World at War was the perfect blend of modern game design and nostalgia-fueled historical combat. Its campaign focuses on the Pacific and Eastern Fronts. It featured iconic voice acting by Kiefer Sutherland and Gary Oldman, and took players around the world to several notable locations from the war. I don't think I need to tell you how significant COD's impact has been for multiplayer gaming. COD 4 really kicked the franchise into overdrive, which somewhat overshadowed World at War's excellent multiplayer. Despite that, World at War is still regarded as a top World War II multiplayer title. It features tanks in addition to the typical COD FPS gameplay, as well as the classic UAV, mortar, and attack dog killstreaks. World at War also launched the massively successful Call of Duty Zombies mode. It was originally just a minigame unlocked at the end of the campaign, but was expanded to 3 additional DLC maps. Zombies has gone on to become one of the 3 main staples of the COD franchise. It has a dedicated fan base that is often more loyal to the Zombies mode than any other aspect of the game. Many players think it could be spun off as its own franchise. Medal of Honor, one of the biggest World War II beasts of its time, is today somewhat of a forgotten franchise. Its 2002 entry, Allied Assault, and our number 2 pick for this list, was one of the biggest World War II hits in gaming of its time. Its original designer, Jason West and Vince Zampella, went on to create the Call of Duty franchise and later formed Respawn Entertainment. Medal of Honor was unique in that film director Steven Spielberg was directly involved in creating it. His creative team that helped develop Saving Private Ryan also helped produce the Medal of Honor franchise. Allied Assault, in addition to being an iconic World War II game in its own right, was informed heavily by scenes in Saving Private Ryan. The iconic landing at D-Day scene is probably one of the more standout moments. When most gamers think of World War II games, they probably think of missions they played in Allied Assault. For many, it was the first standout title in the genre that really sold the atmosphere and grandeur of World War II. Its legacy can be seen in many World War II titles. Obviously, Call of Duty has a deep connection to Medal of Honor, as the same people essentially spearheaded both franchises. But many World War II titles, even modern ones, draw from Allied Assault's approach to iconic battles. Now, if you're familiar with my channel, I don't think you'd expect anything else as my number one pick. Battlefield 1942 didn't just propel its developers DICE to superstardom, it's also essentially the reason this channel even exists. I began my YouTube channel covering Battlefield 3, but I first fell in love with the franchise when it began back in 2002. Battlefield 1942 was one of the first large-scale FPS multiplayer games ever. Only a few games before it could even claim to match similar player numbers, but certainly not with the same details, physics, or popularity that Battlefield 1942 was able to achieve. It defined an entire genre of gaming and led to one of the biggest franchises of all time. Before Battlefield 1942, World War II games were almost exclusively linear shooter experiences or somewhat clunky simulators. Battlefield combined the two and made it accessible to anyone with a computer. Single player? We don't need one of those. It was a pure experience, designed for one thing. Massive World War II battles mixing both player-controlled infantry and vehicle combat. The settings pretty much spanned the entire theater of World War II, offering things like Battle of the Bulge, Stalingrad, Iwo Jima, El Alamein, and even Midway, if you can believe it. Its DLC covered more Italian battles and even added some experimental weapon content with helicopters towards the end of the game's life cycle. The game was a perfect blend of realism and arcadey mechanics. Also, because in-game physics systems were still pretty new for the time, there was a ton of fun and funny bugs like the ability to lay down on the wings of an airplane and machine gun people on the battlefield as you flew overhead. The quirky elements here could be viewed as bugs, but they also helped establish a more fun and lighthearted nature that stuck with the franchise throughout most of its releases. Battlefield 1942 makes the top of my list not only for being a great World War II game, but also for redefining the possibilities of gaming itself, both by pioneering the scale and scope of multiplayer FPS gaming and also adding in a huge amount of teamwork. And that wraps it up for my top 10 World War II games list. Let me know what you guys think of my top picks in the comments down below. As always, thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed it. Don't forget to subscribe, turn on notifications, and I'll see you next time. This is Level Cap, signing off.